Good evening, everybody. I would like to welcome you all to the session one of April's Chiomics Club. And the topic for this session is agricultural bioinformatics. Before beginning with the session, I would like to brief you all with what Chiomics is and what is the initiative behind that. So Chiomics is a bioinformatics and data science student club that is an initiative taken by students associated with Pine Biotech. The main aim of this club is to help students learn about different things that are beyond the school and textbook curriculum. And this club aims at encouraging young minds to push their critical thinking limits beyond the school and college curriculum. I'm Ritu Vajan. I'm serving as the president of this club. And for any of the campus related queries and regarding the upcoming sessions and whatever, you can feel me like emailing at the email ID given over here. What do we do in Chiomics Club sessions? So we do have interactive sessions in which we discuss topics related to infectious diseases, microbiology comprising of and microbiome studies. We also discuss plant science and neuroscience. We also have a discussion about how to apply big data in biology. We make students familiar with how to read literature reviews. We clear the concepts of bioinformatics. This would help the students to gain experience on data science skill sets. And also we talk about topics related to precision oncology. Together, this would help to gain an insight on how to use the tools of bioinformatics and also certain kinds of brainstorming sessions, which would help them to enhance their critical thinking abilities. So moving further, we also have free courses on our website, that is EduTBio, that is namely Introduction to Bioinformatics and Introduction to Genomics. So they are self-learning and assessment course, and you can take them anytime if anyone is interested in knowing about the basics of bioinformatics. There are certain kinds of activities that we do on a daily basis, that we have two sessions a month, and we do group discussions on certain scientific topics. We have review report writing on certain self-access course that I just mentioned before. We have debate, we have presentations. We also have live demonstrations of hands-on experiments, like how do we find a particular data set, how do we store them in Excel file, how to find a p-value, and further on. In this way, we discuss certain types of ideas and exchange them so that we can take forward and build our own research question. So I already told you how to join the club. You can email me at this email ID, or either you can join directly by the WhatsApp group link chat given over here. Also, there is no age limitation. We include all ages because I think that knowledge has no boundaries, and hence we welcome all ages. So now we would begin today's session, that is agriculture and bioinformatics. So first, before dwelling into the convergence of agriculture and bioinformatics, I would like to brief you about what actually bioinformatics is on a very basic scale. So it is like, I would like to give you an example that if you want to map a certain kind of genome of a particular organism, say human or animal, you cannot do it manually. It would be a very tiring task and it would take ample of time. So to discard this all difficulties encountered, there was bioinformatics, and bioinformatics includes instruments like computational biology and technologies like high throughput sequencing, amplicons, and certain other computer tools, which helps us to read big biology data in a very simpler way. If one wants to annotate or interpret certain kinds of large literature reviews and big biological data, then bioinformatics comprises of several kinds of computational techniques one can use through in order to get through those big data and analyze them. On my right hand side, you can see a picture of Human Genome Project. In 2003, it was very costly to do the Human Genome Project, and it took a very long time also. As you see, we come down to past these all years. In 2017, the cost has reduced so much. This is because the advancements in bioinformatics and its tools that helps us to do such hard tasks at such an easier pace with an affordable cost and time as well. So now as we delve into the convergence of bioinformatics and how it is related to agriculture, it is a very basic point of view to analyze that bioinformatics helps to enhance the branch of plant genomics, that is agriculture. The one of the most important roles bioinformatics plays is in crop optimization. By crop optimization, I mean that if we take a crop and if we want to enhance the way it grows, the way it adapts to its environment, and further, you know, the kind of facilities it goes through, the environmental resistance and the drought capacity, etc. The crop optimization consists of all these things, and bioinformatics can play a role and is playing a very major role in enhancing the crop optimization of the plant. Similarly, genetic engineering of plants and plant genome is also carried out to improve the quality of the products of plants that the plants are giving. One very common example of that is Bacillus thuringiensis, that is the BT cotton, which was the first success of the branch of agrogenomics. There is one certain example that is out of India, that is in North America. There were pine trees that were attacked by a substance called G. clevigera. So now this substance was upregulating enzymes that were involved in beta oxidation of fatty acids in mitochondria, due to which the pine trees were constantly attacked. Because of bioinformatics, the sequence of the plant pine trees was suggested, studied, analyzed, and later on techniques were found in order to stop the destruction of pine trees by G. clevigera. This is how bioinformatics and agriculture go hand in hand with each other. When we talk about bioinformatics, there are certain levels we talk about, that is the molecular levels, the structural levels. So talking about the structural genomics, rather than calling bioinformatics and agriculture, we would now use the term plant genomics, which is more suitable. So with the scope of plant genomics going hand in hand, there are many kinds of metabolites, drugs, and resistance to several other chemical compounds that can be taken into account while considering a particular type of plant. So how this plant genomics could be used? So first is we can sequence the genome of certain kinds of non-model plant species. Like there are certain kinds of model plant species like Arabidopsis and rice and Thaliana and etc. So they are perfect model species of plant which are used for plant genomic studies. There are several other plant species such as those are not used in the laboratory, whose sequence is very hard to be sequenced and further on. So such plant genomics branches can be used to study the sequence of such plant species. We can also list down the genes that are upregulated or downregulated while studying the sequence of a particular type of plant. We can also find out with the help of these studies that are there any genes that are showing single nucleotide polymorphism, or are there any types of mutations that are present in that genome which could be corrected and later on be used as a tool for drug resistance or resistance against environment and further on. Also, we know that genome-wide association studies is usually very much needed in order to have a proper hand about the genome of a particular species. Using those studies, we could map the genome sequencing of that particular species and identify mutations, alleles, or certain kinds of candidate genes that are overexpressed. And certain types of other technologies also include marker chip panel for genotyping, selection, and annotation. So I would like to stop over here and ask the audience if they would have any questions. Please put it down in the chat box. Or either you can unmute yourself and ask me questions. Okay, if no questions, I would presently like to move forward. And if you have, in case, you can just put it down in the chat box. I will answer them at the end. Thank you. So moving further, when we talk about plant genomics, how important it is to you know, genome sequence and sequencing of certain genomes of plant species. So on my left hand side, you see a picture that is a picture of a whole mitochondrial genome. An actual genome looks like this, with certain kinds of places, certain kinds of rRNA also shown, and certain kinds of cleavage side zones, which shows the activity of certain kinds of enzyme on those sites. So first, what is a genome? So a genome comprises of the whole genetic material of an organism, which also includes elements like viruses, plasmids, or transposable elements like Golgi bodies, ER, mitochondria, etc. But in eukaryotes, like plants, also prokaryotes and animals, genome comprises of the information on chromosomal DNA, that is the genetic material. To sequence this genome reveals a lot more about an organism. If we sequence a genome of a particular organism, it can give us the information about its hereditary, the kind of disease it can go through, the kind of mutations, alleles, and candidate genes present in them, the defects it can go through, and also the improvements one can make by studying the genome of a particular organism. In this slide, you can see the image of a plastome. A plastome means the genome of a plastid. So to have a better understanding of genome evolution, we have developed certain kinds of greater techniques, which shows how to study genomic sequences easier in less time and affordable cost. So the agricultural genomics is a term which was actually invented to innovate certain kinds of ideas and techniques in order to study these genomes for better productivity, for better survival of the plants, to better have plants survive in conditions such as drought conditions, less water, less salt, in harsh conditions, so that the plants can even grow well in certain kinds of conditions where there are arid areas or no water, or even in desert areas. Any questions? Okay, speaking about metagenome analysis. So metagenome analysis is a greater picture of genomic sequencing. So there is a particular protocol that is followed for metagenome analysis of any particular organism or species. First is very common, that is, we extract their DNA, and then we separate the DNA into its fragments, that is called as fragmentation. After fragmentation, the sequence is read and interpreted on the computer screen with the help of the technologies that one is using. After DNA sequencing, the taxonomic profiling of that sequence is done, that includes the phylogenetic tree, separation of the sequences according to their hereditary and further on. And in that, it is identified if that sequence is having any kind of virulence factor, and hence they are undergoing a process that is known as virulence factor analysis. After that, the functional profiling of that particular sequence is done. Now, what is functional profiling? So that sequence is, you know, exposed to certain kinds of drugs or chemicals to find out that if they are having certain kinds of effects, are they upregulated, the sequence is either affected or not affected by that drug or chemical. And later on, the results are interpreted, and this is how the drug resistance or the resistance of the plant to certain kind of substance or chemical is taken into consideration, and then the results are analyzed and interpreted. So this is the basic protocol for metagenome analysis. However, metagenome analysis till now has helped us to improve the qualities of the soil in which the plant can grow better and can have better yield and productivity. So now, since we know a basic picture of what plant genomics consists of, we would see the examples. That is, first is the rice gene transfer. So this was a very big breakthrough in plant genomics. So we know that diseases like blindness occur due to the deficiency of vitamin A, and diseases like anemia occur due to deficiency of iron. So in order to resolve such health problems, the bioinformaticians and scientists came together, and they, you know, transferred certain kinds of genes in the pathway of beta carotene production in rice So these genes helped in the production, greater production of vitamin A and iron respectively. And due to this, the quality of golden rice was enhanced, and hence it could overcome the problems of deficiency of vitamin A and iron respectively. So after this example, you could have a better view and a picture of how bioinformatics can actually dwell with plant genomics. We'll look at the second example of that, that is the BT cotton. It is an example of structural genomics as well. So now BT was a gene that was found by the scientists that was thought to have control the effects of certain kinds of insects on that plant. So now this gene was transferred into cotton plant because cotton plant was attacked by insects known as lepidopteran insects. And this insects used to produce toxins, which was not good for the cotton plant. So scientists transferred this gene that is known as BT gene into the cotton plants so as to protect themselves from these insects and also the kind of toxins it produces. So this is now known as BT cotton plant, and this is even a greater breakthrough for plant genomics to go through. So any questions?
Ruthvi, I think you can go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. So we have certain kinds of models. If you can guys relate, in wet lab studies, we have models of mouse and we also have human samples, but that is after a great research experience. Similarly for plant genomics, we also have plant models on which research is carried out. One of the example is Arabidopsis thaliana. It is a very well-known plant model that is used for studies of plant genomics. Its reproduction rate is very faster. Also, it has fast life cycle and hence it can reproduce very fast. And also it has developed certain kinds of characteristics to overcome stress and environmental resistance. And that is the reason it can be used for, you know, plant genomic studies. Also, it has greater impact on studies of metabolism and transcription, as you can see over here. And over here, you can see the studies listed down, like protein synthesis, intracellular transport, and etc., which could be studied using Thaliana as a model organism for plant genomics. So the whole genome of Thaliana has been duplicated and it is completely sequenced, and it has 25,498 genes that encode from proteins from 11,000 different families, and hence you can imagine why it is the most suitable model organism for agrigenomics. And moving to the last topic of my presentation, that is molecular plant breeding. So molecular plant breeding is again similarly designed at a molecular level for genetic engineering of plants in order to overcome diseases, or I must say conditions like abiotic stress tolerance. Certain kinds of plants need to be engineered in that way so that they can overcome cold, drought, immersion, salt area, etc. Also, they are used for inducing biotic stress tolerance, like activity against protection, like fungal, bacterial, and viral infections. They are also used to enhance nutrition efficiency in certain kinds of plants. As example, we saw that is rice. And management of certain kinds of diseases, like certain kinds of plants produce amount of diseases which are not good for other plants dwelling besides them. So molecular plant breeding is also the branch that is used for that. Also hybridization, in-cross hybridization, the cross-genome, cross-culturing are also certain kinds of terms that are using molecular plant breeding, in which we develop a plant of our own characteristics by cross-hybridization of two other plant species that has some characteristics and the other one has the some characteristics, and later on we produce a hybrid that has characteristics of both the plants. So this is certain kind of idea of what molecular plant breeding consists of. And I think this is the end of my presentation. Can I please have questions from you? Okay, so there is a question there. Are there differences in functional profiling of organisms and genome annotation? So yes, there are differences in functional profiling of organisms and genome annotation, because we do functional profiling in order to find out that is the sequence, I mean the genome sequence, is, you know, affected by certain kinds of chemical compound, or if I want to test any kind of drug resistance of that particular genome sequence or the drug. Whereas in genome annotation, what we do is identify the location of the genes and the coding regions in a genome and determine what those genes do or their function is. So functional profiling and genome annotation are quite different on these terms. By these terms, I mean the viewpoint of drug resistance, chemical substance, or certain other kinds of harmful substance. I hope I answered your question. You're welcome.
So if there are no more questions, shall we start with the hands-on analysis for today?
Yeah, sure, Sonalika. So after my session, she's Sonalika, and she's a research intern with Pine Biotech, and she would be taking a live hands-on demonstration and would be demonstrating you guys about how to annotate and extract a plant genome. So over to you, Sonalika. Thank you.
Thanks, Ruthvi. Okay, so first of all, I want this session to be interactive. I don't want to be the one talking only. So I want everybody to like answer and even ask questions, right? So today we would be doing a differential gene expression analysis. And we would look for the differentially expressed genes in a data set that is obviously of a plant, Z maize, and the title of the data set is The Wheat Presents Altered Biotic Stress and Light Signaling in Maize, Even When Weeds Were Removed Early in the Critical Weed-Free Period. So before we start, I just want to just quickly revise the basic concepts. So the main four points in the logic of RNA-seq analysis are pre-processing of the raw reads from input files, and then the aligning of the reads and mapping on a reference genome, then calculating the abundance of reads aligned to that particular reference genome, and then doing the statistical or the biological interpretation of the expression table. So now I would like to ask, what are the tools for pre-processing? Anybody can just unmute and tell. Tools for pre-processing.
I guess it's PCR clean and Trimomatic.
Thanks, Dhruv. And what does PCR clean and Trimomatic do?
PCR clean, I guess, is a like algorithm for removing PCR duplicates with low quality. And Trimomatic actually, I guess, removes the adapter sequences, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah, you are right. Thank you so much. And the step two is to map the reference genome. And mapping with the reference genome involves which all tools? If anybody, if I'm not wrong, Clinton is one from the Pine Data. Clinton, can you tell me, please? Okay, anybody else? Oh, somebody saying something. Bounty 2, Callisto, and Top Hat. Okay, you're right.
Sonalika, I think Clinton just answered in the chat.
Yeah, he just said that. Yeah. No issues. Maybe he can tell in the next part. Okay, so what are the other tools to calculate the abundance of reads? So we get a table here, and that is the RSEM table, right? So now just let me share my screen and let's start the analysis. And also I would want you guys to ask any doubts if you have in carrying out a project or like anything, then just ask. Okay, so this is the data set which we would be using. It's weed presence altered biotic stress and light signaling in maize even when weeds were removed early in the critical weed free period, right? So how you choose your data set, OpenGEO, and do everything, I hope you all know. So I'm not going from step one. So I've already chosen one of the data sets which I would like to work on. And then we have two sorts of groups here, let's say. One is from 2007 and the another one is from 2008. And here we have a control group and a VD group. And one group is like the weeds were removed first and then the response was seen, right? So if we start with PCA, so for the PCA we go to utilities. I'm using the T-Bioinfo platform server and I just wanted you guys to have a look like how the server is used for those who are new to it. And yes, those who have already practiced can just have a good revision, and then they would definitely learn something new in the analysis part. That's for sure. Okay, so what you do, what you do here, you just download the file here. You can either download the series matrix file or you could directly download the file from here. Now, there is one thing which we interns often face is that we just download the file and we start doing the normalization and then we are like, oh, we are not getting the results. Why is that so? So make sure that you open one of the samples, like any one of the sample, and go to data processing and just see what sort of data you have downloaded. Either it is raw read count data or either it is normalized. So if it is already normalized, obviously you need not go for the normalization step and you can directly go to the differential expression analysis part, right? Another part is, if your data has got just two samples, or let's say just two groups, might be not two samples, but let's say just two groups with say 10 samples each, then you can go for the analysis of differential expression directly with t-test. Now, these are few points which I really wanted to highlight because while going through the project, we often do these mistakes. So t-test is just for two groups, and if there are more than two groups, then you have to go for another statistical analysis that could be your ANOVA or just to like look for Z-scores, right? So we would definitely do ANOVA and Z-score too in the future. So today we'll just try to stick to t-test for itself, right? So here we have got two groups. I have just made two groups, the 7-1 and the 8-1. So if you go to the utilities part, you have to upload the file here. So I've already downloaded the file. That's why I'm not downloading it again, right? So this is the file here and you just upload it. After the upload is complete, you guys want to perform it with me or like you would just want to see? Anybody can unmute and tell, please.
Sonalika, I don't think everyone would have an access to T-Bio platform. So I think they can just see, and those who have the access can go with you.
Yeah, that would be better. So yeah, if anybody wants to go through, like they can, or just see. Okay, fine. So once the upload is complete, you go to the start button and then you go to quantile normalization and PCA. I think I should just show you with the steps. Okay, so what is PCA? Like, how does PCA help us understand our samples? Anybody?
So I guess PCA is a dimensional reduction analysis. So it actually, summarizes our data in a 2D graph. And it basically epitomizes the variation in the gene, the gene expression of various samples.
Right. Thank you so much, Dhruv. Someone is asking, okay, Ritika is asking something. Just give me a second. As we all know that cholesterol is Linux, so what alternative can we have for Windows? Okay, Ritika, so we are going through a pipeline actually, and I'll tell you each and every possible method out here, right? And also I'll tell you about Excel. And what are the other sort of tools which you can use? I will definitely tell you that. But here, actually, we wanted to just discuss the Excel part and the pipeline part. So this T-Bio Info server, I think you are new to it. So this server has been designed in a way to make things like very much easier for the students. Like they could just do the analysis on just one click, and all they have to do is spend time on the further analytical part and not running the analysis, right? So I let you know other tools. And then have you ever tried Galaxy Europe? Yes, we have. It has various tools. Yes, we have. Okay, so we would discuss that later. Thank you so much. Okay, so for PCA, you click on start and then go to quantile normalization. What would quantile normalization do? Anybody except Dhruv? Ruthvi, can you tell me?
It normalizes our raw read data counts into a normal structure.
Okay, thank you so much. So yes, we want the values to be transformed to log normalized values. So we do a yes, and threshold we set to 5, and then we start the PCA. We put a filter by max 25%, save it, and then end the analysis. And we give it a name to our pipeline. So I'm not giving it a name and doing the pipeline because I've already run it, and I would just like to show you the results.
Okay, so
yeah,
before showing the result, Emeka is asking in the chat that is it possible to have an idea about how your text file looks for analysis? So can you just show
yeah,
that?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so what we did was we downloaded the file from here, right? And once our file was, okay, I'm not downloading it again. So once our file was downloaded, no, we could see it over here. So this is my file. Fine, this is my file. And it many a times it becomes difficult for me specifically to understand my samples in a notepad. So yes, I just export it to an Excel sheet and look for the details, right? Many a times in GEO datasets, you would get a series matrix file where you would actually have a lot of details which you won't want. So that is not related to our analysis for now, but I'm just showing it to you so that you understand. Okay, like this, something like this, right? So here you have all the details of what sort of analysis was done and about the samples, about their phenotypes, about their expression, and et cetera, the much needed details. So when you upload that, but this particular file, you could just delete the upper part up to the sample IDs, right? And then take that particular file for further analysis. Right? Okay. We have one more question. Give it. Okay. Sorry, Ruthi. Fine. Okay. So what you did was you uploaded your file over there, and then you got the result for the PCA. And now I just want you guys to have a look at what the PCA output file looks like. So once your PCA is run, you would get the results like this, fine? So this is quantile normalized pipeline, which I had already run. It was just a few hours ago. Okay, so you get the results like this, and the file like which I want for further analysis would be this particular file. So I just simply download it and then I can view it and try to understand the values. Fine. So now I would like to take this file. I've already opened that particular file in Excel. I hope like you guys know how you open a notebook file in Excel. A yes or no would work. Okay, so I'm taking it as a yes then. So there are many a times people actually get confused. That's why I just asked. Okay, fine. Thank you. So now this is your quantile normalized values. And if you would compare this with the raw read count data, let's do that so that you know why we actually did quantile normalization. Okay, so see now how your values are actually going to extremes if you compare this particular set of rows, let's say, right? Your values are going to extremes actually. Where is the another file? Okay, and if you see the quantile normalized file, can you just see how closely related the values become? So it's easier for us to compare the values. That's the reason why we just convert the normal values, the raw read count values, to normalized data. Fine. And once we are done with quantile normalization, then we would want to see those particular values on a PCA plot. So for that, what we would do on our T-Bioinfo server only, we would go to the unsupervised analysis, and then we would upload the file. Okay, so till it's uploading and finishes the processing, can anybody tell me what a PCA plot tells? What sort of groups does it show? Shall I give you options? You can unmute yourself. 2D graph of variables among groups. Okay, and it actually tells us about the clusters in the samples, right? So we have different sort of samples, and we could just have a look at the clusters. So it's taking time. Maybe my net is slow. That's why it's taking so much of time to get processed. Anyways, I'll just show you the plot from here. So this is like how the clusters can be seen through a PCA plot. And so once you have your normalized values, you have seen your clusters, and now you would definitely want to carry out the differential gene expression analysis. So I'm not carrying out the PCA plot for now because I think my server is slow. So I will directly move to differential expression analysis. Now, here, one thing you have to consider is that you should not be taking the normalized data, which we just like normalized through PCA. Here, you have to take the raw read counts. Also, it's mentioned out here. So you have to take the raw read counts, and again, you upload the same file, and then you carry out the analysis by selecting your groups, and then you start the analysis through, and then click HR. HR is again your differential expression analysis tool, and DSEC2 again is one of them. And then you end the analysis, and then you would be getting results as of this. So you could simply download your output file from here, and you can view your output. So I've just downloaded it. Okay. Okay, and in your HR file, you would be getting log FC, log CPM, and p values and FDR. So, anybody can tell me what FDR is? Guys, please interact.
False discovery rate.
Okay, like and why do we need it, Dhruv?
Because when we have a large number of data, like data samples, so there are like chances that like the non-significant values might seem significant. So that's why we do FDR, I guess.
Thank you so much. So yes, he's right. So FDR is done just to remove the false positive values. Fine. So this is something you would get here, and your FDR should be less than one. Make sure that your FDR should, like, it should be less than one and not equal to or more than one, because that would be signifying false positive values. Okay, so it is very easy to find out, like to run the analysis through, like through the server and get your result and then look for the differentially expressed genes. Let's do it quickly over here and then we will shift to Excel.
Analytica.
Yeah, I'm so sorry.
There's a question in the chat box.
Sorry. Is FDR and no, it's not the same. FDR and adjacent p-value is not the same, but yes, they are. FDR is a value which would actually help us to remove the false positives, yes. And adjacent p-value is calculated from the p-value through the ranks itself. And it also helps us to remove the false positive values, but it is like, it's a derived variable that you need to calculate it, right? But FDR is something that you would get directly straight away. In a way, you can say they are equal, but like they are similar, but not equal. And the values for both of them are different. For adjacent p-value, you have to put a filter of values less than 0.05. And for FDR, you have to put a filter of values less than 1. I hope that answers your question. Okay, so here in the file, you won't be getting adjusted p-values. Because why so? Because your sample had just two groups, right? That's the first reason. And here to look for the differentially expressed genes is actually very easy for you guys. So let's actually do it once. Let's first filter those p-values. Okay, so we have students from different sort of years and degrees. That's why I would do the basics also over here. And for those who know, it's good, but for others I would be doing. Yes, so your p-value should be less than 0.05, right? So we would... Where is that? Yes. So what we would do here, we would just keep those particular values for those, the p-value is less than 0.05 and then delete the rest, fine? And what is log FC? What does log FC tell us? How do I get to the chat? Anybody, please?
Go up.
Okay, got it.
Thank you.
Okay, first of all, what is FC? So you guys don't tell me, I would take it as a no that you don't know.
Kavya so, says it is a fold change.
thank you. Yes, you are right. And what does it tell, Kavya? What does it tell? So if you have two samples, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, as you are saying, if there are two samples, how different is it from the other sample? How much fold it's increasing, 2 times, 3 times, it would tell that.
Okay, thank you so much. Yes, so our fold change should be high, right? So we could just put that filter on here and get the differentially expressed genes from here. So that's pretty much easier, right? But now what if you have a data set in which you have multiple groups, not just two, but multiple groups. Sorry, I meant how can one make his her gene ID match his her gene ontology ID? Oh, that's very easy. So what you have to do is you would be getting a file over here in your this platform ID file, GPL154 for us over here, right? So you could download this file and shall I just download it for you? So you could just download this file and here you would get a list of your IDs matching your gene IDs. matching your gene symbol, sorry. List of IDs matching your gene symbols. I don't know what's wrong with my download files. It's going up and down. Anyways. Just give me a second, Kavya. I'll just get back to this once we finish the Excel thing. We'll definitely get back to this and try to just put those things together. So what happens in GPL, no? You get an option to download the file. So you get an option here to download the table and then you can download it very easily. So I'll just show you one of the IDs which I was working on to show you how it comes up. So see, if you click on the platforms, no, you get an option to download this table. Like you get an option to download the full table. And if I download it, so my IDs are mentioned here and my genes assigned to these particular IDs are mentioned here. So I could simply like download the file, open an Excel and put a filter and just keep the gene symbols for these particular genes and then go ahead. So that's the way. But you can try it for your data set, like if you get this particular table or not, right? And if not, then we could look for an alternate method. Okay, you have something, 10 minutes only left. Okay, so I have to finish it up really quick. We have a session at 8:30, right? Okay, so I wanted to do this just because I was myself stuck at some work and then I... Give me a second. So I'm opening this quantile normalized data set over here. And then I would try to find out the P value, Q value, log FDR value from this particular data set in Excel itself, right? So I'm doing this just because many a times for multiple samples, we are not able to run the analysis. And it's really easy in Excel. And yes, it's not mentioned at many much places. Like, okay, so he's sending something. Thank you so much, Clinton. Is it for Kavya? What is it?
Some info about FDR. It's
okay, some info about FDR. Yeah. Fine. Okay, I thought it's something for Kavya. Okay, so we first save this particular file in Excel. Okay. Does anybody want to assist me in carrying out the analysis from Excel or no? Thank you so much, Clinton. Okay, so what I'm doing, I'm just trying to make my data set a little simpler just because we have got less time left, right? So I'm removing the VD response column and I'm just keeping the VD and control column and removing others. So because it would take time actually if I keep all the columns, right? So how you calculate P value now in Excel? Do t-test, so t-test, and the formula is array 1, array 2, tails and type. Array 1, first group, then comes array 2, second group. It's a tool-tailed distribution test, so 2, and it's a 2 sample unequal variance test, so 3. Why unequal? Because our sample's length is not equal. Right, and then I just click here and get the p values. Okay, so for 0 obviously the values would be okay, fine. And how do you calculate log FC? it's equal to average. The first array, close minus average. Second set, right? That's how you calculate log FC. And how you calculate Q value. First of all, for Q value, you need to rank your data set. So let's rank it. Okay, so it has copied everything. I fill the series. So we need. So now we have a ranked data set. We have ranks for each of our IDs. Now we calculate Q value. We are doing this Q value calculation through Benjamin E. Hochberg test, which is again to remove the false positives. So for Q value, what we do is we go to the end of our data set. Formula for Q value is equal to minimum value of P value multiplied by the total number of values in our data set, that is 27497, divided by the rank. Fine. Close it, enter. And now you have to take it. Okay, so now I need to scroll. If anybody else knows a method to take this column up to the like the first column, then first row, do let me know. Was it helpful? I can't read the chat. I have held this. Ruthi, could you please read the question for me?
Go ahead.
Yeah. You can click K.
I mean, wait, you know what? Let's not try that. Okay. Doesn't that do it?
Yeah. Oh, no, it doesn't. It's actually a very big problem for me also. I don't like holding this particular tab. It doesn't work this way.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. Okay, so that's how you calculate, Clinton. So I'll have to go back to the last of the row. No issues at all. Okay, fine. So that's how you calculate the Q value, P value, and fold change. And now we'll quickly put a filter and then try to find out the differentially expressed genes. We still have 4 minutes left. I think we could complete it. One more message, Ruthvi, please read.
I cannot read that. That's for you.
Just give me a second. So I have to hold it. Okay, fine. So was it helpful, guys? Otherwise, I could have actually put a filter onto the P values and then calculated the Q values for that. But anyhow, let's actually take the whole data set into consideration. Okay, so.
So, Nalika, you're done with your part?
Yes. So, now we could just like put a filter. Right. Putting a filter means you could just go to this filter option and then just click the values less than 0.05 for P value and then log FC value in the range of 2 to -2. And then you could just put all your data set in the descending order. And yes, you would have your differentially expressed gene. So that was it. If you have any guys, do let me know. In the group itself. Thank you.
Do you guys have any further questions? We can take one or two more questions if you guys have. I think there are no more questions, so it's time to say goodbye. So thank you everyone for joining in today.
I think like we should ask them like whatever topics they would want to discuss on in any of the fields or any subdomain of your work, you could actually ask in the group, right? And let us know if you want a particular session on a particular topic or a hands-on on a particular topic, right? So because it gets a lot difficult for us to decide a particular topic, which could actually be helpful to each one of you. So yeah.
Yeah, you can either put it down in the group or email us. And you guys have been a wonderful audience. Thank you for your time. And I really appreciate you being here. I hope to see you next Thursday. Till then, take care and goodbye.